it just came to me. I just thought, what is the point? They've just cut down all the trees. And so I threw the petition all over the floor of the council chamber, and we had to witness all of these hypocrites stick up their hands to declare a climate emergency in Lewisham Borough the day they cut down 74 mature trees. I mean, you couldn't make this up, really, could you? The plans for the garden started in 2008, and most of us didn't realise what was going on. It started with the appointment of the highest paid primary school head teacher in the country. His job was to try and pass the idea of it becoming an academy. Now, what that entails then is private finance. The community began to learn about the plans for Tidemill, and at the same time, we realised the levels of pollution were increasing year on year, and it was proved that the garden mitigated pollution by half. We felt that we had to fight for this space because it's about people's health, and also we knew how serious the housing crisis was and felt that why should council homes be demolished?
Let go of her! Let go of her!
Oh, you can't! Stop it!
The head garden! Make some fucking noise!
It was like living in a police state, and walking down Reginald Road and seeing all these security guards who weren't very pleasant, particularly to the neighbours, especially the women. I mean, these are the people that our council employed to basically attack their constituents and to intimidate their constituents. And what did we have to win? I mean, it was a piece of public land that we were trying to protect. We weren't getting any, you know, money for doing this. We weren't going to get any position of power. We weren't, you know, it wasn't going to be another step up the ladder in the political arena for any of us. It was purely because we cared about our local community and the assets, the very few that we had left. And land is the basis for all capitalism, and they call themselves socialists, and yet their housing policy does not reflect any kind of socialist principles, because once you sell off public land, you know, you're basically selling off the family silver, as we say. No, you don't get it back again. We joined with the Reginald House residents for a two-pronged resistance to the plans. And part of that was one of the young people was in his final year studying architecture and came up with an alternative plan. And so that gave us huge amounts of hope. You know, they can get as many homes as they want, but we can save, if not all, most of the garden and the council homes. Wow, we've come up with a solution. And they weren't going to have it. They weren't having it because it would have cost them another 50,000. And they just refused to do it. And yet they spent 980,000 on securing the school after they kicked out the guardians in 1 year. And to date, we know that it's more than £3.5 million that they have spent on security for Tidemill. Why couldn't they have spent that bit of money, the £50,000 that we asked them to spend, in order that we could work together to find a more suitable solution.
Oh, I like that. Blue and climate hypocrisy. Yay!
I can see that.
That's brilliant. Two more black and white trees. Can I put 74 somewhere?
Yeah. Can we just go here?
That's great. Anywhere.
Anyone seen the
they're very clever, so they're quite charming face to face. And the council's attitude towards us ultimately was violent, though I would suspect it wasn't necessarily the councillors that were flatly refusing to reconsider the plans. I think it was Sherry Green Holmes and Peabody, having met their representatives at several meetings, and their attitude towards us was incredibly dismissive and patronising, and the head of Sherry Green Holmes basically trying to insinuate that nobody cared. And in a way, I think it's an arrogance to think, why should a bunch of citizens tell us what to do? first time I cried at the thought of losing the garden. And it was a benefit for a Peruvian community whose land was going to be taken over by some mining company. There was a group of South Americans that approached us and asked if they could use the garden to hold a benefit. Two fires were built and all this acoustic music was playing, you know, like Peruvian pipes and guitars, and people were singing and chatting, and there was more music going. The children were doing like big parades with them, fluorescent lights that they'd had. And I just sat there thinking, oh, this is what it's all about, you know, and we were fighting for our space and we were holding a benefit for people that were fighting for theirs. The propaganda that they put out about the people that were saving the garden was that we were people that only cared about our own backyard, as it were, that we were all middle class, that there was a group of outsiders that had come in, and that most people involved in the campaign were outsiders. And they kept repeating this whole idea that it was a meanwhile use. And the other thing, they would diminish the value of the garden, like the cabinet member for housing, Paul Bell, actually referred to it in a radio interview on BBC Radio London. He said, it's not the Hanging Gardens of Babylon or Kew Gardens. So what's he saying? That in anything less than that, it has no value? Right, should we go? Are we ready? Okay, let's go! It was quite shocking for a lot of people in the community to realise what the state is capable of doing if you should go as far as we did, which was to broaden this campaign right across London, Europe. People in Australia were contacting us, people from Peru. We became a bigger and bigger threat. At a demonstration outside a meeting that the mayor was at, the people lay down in the road and were dragged by their feet and hurt. When people were wrongfully arrested on the green for stupid little incidences, they were ready to clamp down on us, you know, for the tiniest little thing. For a lot of people, it was quite shocking. I mean, I had a communist dad, so I was used to, I mean, I knew what the police could do because he was on the picket lines for the miners and whopping dispute. And so I would hear stories from my own father about police brutality against protesters, so I wasn't too surprised about the way they behaved.
There are alternatives. We gave them alternatives. Our council is not listening to us. So this is why we're having this demonstration today.
The most valuable thing, it emerges from our action, was that we became a stronger community together, and that all the diverse members of this, a lot of the diverse members of our community, including the people that are most hit by austerity, people that are the most vulnerable, squatters, local residents, all artists, musicians, people all came together for a common purpose. There was no structural leadership. People could input into whatever they wanted to do. Someone could pass the garden and we'd say, and they'd go, oh, what's happening here? And then, well, if you've got any ideas, you're very welcome to you know, hold an event or something. So I think the benefit of that was that it's brought us together when we may have lost the garden, but the council flats are still there. So don't ever be put off from taking part in resistance because of our experience of actually losing in the end, because we've not always lost.